what do you understand by real estate? See, real estate is basically something which is like, you know, land and any structure that is built on it, either on it or on it. So it can be either commercial, it can be residential, and nowadays you have concepts like SEZ also used, right? So real estate has become a huge investment opportunity. Now, real estate earlier times, you used to only look at it in terms of, you know, investing in a house of your own. As an investment option, it was not that important. Because people generally invested in a house for their own security and something to build. They realize that, you know, real estate as an investment category is an entirely separate category, and it is possible that you can make huge gains on it. Now, there are many ways of investing in real estate. See, now one of course is you have a loan amount, right? Number two, you can, you know, invest in a, let's say, like a flat or a house or whatever, right? Then you also have something like limited real estate partnerships. You have real estate investment trust. You have real estate mutual funds. Right? You have something like duplication property. Okay? You have limited partnerships. Right? You have something like mortgage. Right? You must have heard of that subprime crisis in the US. That is also a form of investment in real estate. Okay? Wherein whatever the money that is coming from loans and stuff is further collateralized and sold to. So let me discuss example of investing in land. Now land is, because of the factor of demand and supply, land is always in scarcity. So if you decide to go and buy land, and let's say maybe on the tip of Kanyakumari or maybe, you know, somewhere in the Himalayas, at some point of time in the future, as population grows and more and more area is getting up, it will acquire value simply because of the fact that it is scarce. But let's say we are not talking about an infinite period, or we are not talking about a very long period, and let's say you have a horizon of 5 to 10 years. Now, if you are buying over land, right, now what are the factors that you really look at? Right? You look at the location of the property. You will look at, when you say location of the property, you look at whether the title deeds are clean, right? There are no issues, it's not something which is a refit, right? What is it from environment and safety standards? In terms of location, you look in terms of, you know, what other residential areas are nearby, what are the property classes here is there, right? What is the good for to construct, okay? Whether there are schools and colleges, whether there is some means of transport that are there or not. So when you are investing in land, these are the factors that you actually look at. Now suppose I invest in, let's say I am building a house. Now if you are building a house, again the same thing. The land is there, the location is there, schools, colleges, access to utilities like water, electricity, etc., etc. That is if you are building it alone. Plus, of course, the cost of construction and the nearby surroundings. Okay? If you go and invest in, let's say, in a multi-story flat or something which is built by a builder, which you are not building. Okay? Now, apart from wherever else in terms of location and stuff, right, the important thing to be taken in this account is what is the reputation of the builder, right? And when is he going to give the possession of the property, where is the property situated, what are the terms of the property, right? Is it high end, is it low end, is it low end, right? Because high end properties generally give in the long run a lower capital appreciation than properties which are in the middle class. Right? For example, if I talk about Gurgaon, right? Now there are properties which you may get for around 30 to 40 lakhs, and there may be properties which you may get something above 2 crores. Right? Now let's say that if you get a property, let's say about 2 crores, how much capital appreciation do you think that you would give? 3 crores? Mm-hmm. Maximum. So what about 1/2? You know? Okay, 50%, right? But in this case, suppose you buy a property of 30 lakhs, right? Over a period of time, it is possible to, you know, actually double it. It may become 60 lakhs. Right? In that case, right, it's almost 100% capital appreciation. So there, in that case, the capital appreciation possibility is much higher. Right? Now when you're investing in terms of flats and stuff, so you have to look at cost of construction, you have to look at safety standards, you have to look at, suppose that property, whichever land that is being built, right, is it disputed, has the, you know, builder got clear title of land for it, right, is it falling into a, you know, a residential area or not, right, or is he using something, for example, you have something in Delhi called Lalgarh, right, and you always, this in terms of problem that you were having in Delhi with regard to property and stuff, right? And you were having this bulldozing and why was it? Because in some cases in the rural area, it was all large rural land. Large rural land is basically agricultural land, where it may say that, you know, for villages and stuff within that territory, they will allow some amount of construction, which is maybe not 1 or 2 stories, and which is only for the use of the villages. Okay? They are not supposed to be giving out it to others to, you know, use at a commercial state. So that is why that large rural land was not supposed to be used. Okay? Similarly, for areas in the residential areas, now there were some rules in terms of, you know, whether it should be used for commercial purposes or for personal purposes. Now, all those places where we say the commercial difference community, all those places, they are primary residential areas and they should have not been commercial property. In some cases, of course, doctors, nursing homes, yes, but if you are buying a commercial property for a shop or something, right, so you also need to look at what is the area that is there and what are the rules and laws there. Right? Then of course you have something like super area, carpet area, covered area, right? Parking charges, right? So the breakup of all those charges need to be looked at. If you are taking a loan, right? Now loans can be of two types in this case. Either what happens, you take the entire amount of loan and you give it to the building entirely, right? Now the entire mortgage is given to the banking portion. Now, in the other cases that you were linked to a cost of construction approach, which in this case also the mortgage is given to the bank, but in this case the builder asks you for a sum of money according to the progress that he has made in terms of the construction. Okay, so depending on, let's say, to the third floor, then this is installment due. So then you go to the bank will advance you, right? So whatever the sum that is advanced, you would end up paying interest only and on that amount. But if you pay a cash down, right, you pay the entire amount at one go of the entire property to the builder, you possibly may get a cash discount. And in that case, it's a clean transaction because your EMI is fixed once, right, and you don't have to keep going to the bank and keep going to the thing regarding that. Every time, you know, the builder says that, okay, I need value, right, so again you go to the bank again, and then the interest rates may have changed or whatever. So it becomes a little difficult proposition. But obviously, interest cost may be lower because you are only being charged on the amount that you are withdrawing at a particular point of time. It is a cost of construction linked to push. Okay? Plus, of course, you look at in terms of, you know, what is the possibility of capital appreciation, what are the capital appreciation of the property in the same value. So, these are the two or three categories that you have, which either you are building from your own in terms of property or your land or in terms of, like, you are buying in a builder property, which is either commercial or residential. Now, the other category, as I said, is one is a real estate limited partnership. Then you have real estate investment trust, you have a real estate mutual fund, and you have something like a mortgage fund. I will start with a real estate investment trust. Now, a real estate investment trust is like a mutual fund in the sense is that a particular class of builders or real estate developers will invest in some commercial property, which may be a variety of commercial property, which can be either commercial or residential. They may either own the property or, right, or they may buy it outright and then decide to use it, or they may decide to lease the property and then get whatever interest out of it. Right? So there are two ways of, you know, actually investing in property. Right? So they may either develop property, sell it directly to, you know, investor, or they may lease the property and get interest out of it. So they have two sources of income. One in terms of sale of property or whatever they are developing, and one in terms of lease and rentals of property that they choose to develop. Now, in that case, suppose you lend money to this real investment trust, right? So, like a mutual fund, they will, whatever they assess the value of their assets divided by, subtract all the liabilities, divide by the total number of units, because as a mutual fund, they will have a certain amount of units. So, there will be an NAV, and depending on how the property and whatever the rental values are to it, so you will get a certain amount of money. Now in this case, it is not possible to declare an NAV daily. Right? At best, they may do it once a month. Okay? I have not come across a solution where they will be doing it beyond that. Right? They could probably, because rentals or whatever things happen, will happen once a month. Right? So in that case, the NAV is something that is there. And there is a certain blocking period. It is obviously not a typical open-ended fund, may not work. There will be some restrictions on buying and selling a fund. There will be in terms of, they will have three dates of buying and selling or limited avenues for getting out of the fund, because in this case, you know, because property is not very liquid, right? It's not as if that today if I want to redeem in a mutual fund, I say I want to redeem in a permanent fund, like I can just go and sell the shares and get the money and give it to you. Right? But in a real estate, the level of liquidity is probably a little lower. So they will have some restrictions as in terms of the lock-in period and in terms of how frequently they allow the redemption or what conditions they will allow the redemption. Then you have a real estate mutual fund. Now, a real estate mutual fund actually invests in a real estate investment trust, which means that, like any other mutual fund, right? Now, a real estate investment trust is typically concentrated only in investing in property. Right? Either they buy the property and sell it directly to investors, or they develop the property or lease it out or, you know, for rentals. But in a real estate mutual fund, they are investing in real estate investment trusts, right? So they may possibly invest also in, let's say, shares of real estate companies. Okay, so their portfolio is slightly different from a real estate investment trust. Right? A real estate investment is typically more into property development and stuff. But a real estate mutual fund will use either a real estate investment trust as part of the portfolio or real estate companies into shares and stuff. So they have more flexibility and the liquidity probably will be a little bit higher. Then you have a class called a real estate limited partnership. Okay. Now, right now in India, you don't have a REIT or a real estate mutual fund because there are some issues still with regard to valuation, and they're still not developed to such an extent that you will have something like a real estate investment fund. There are some regulatory issues as well. In that case, people have started coming out with real estate limited partnership. Now, in this case, what happens is, let's say, you know, some people combine together and they combine some money and they form a partnership, right? And that partnership invests in some project. Okay? For example, let's say, you know, 30-40 of us, right, decide that, you know, we want to buy some property on MT Road, right? So we build a partnership and we go and invest in a property. Now, some of us would be general partners and some of us would be limited partners. Right? When I say limited partners, my limited liability only to the extent of money that I have invested. I will lose only that amount of money beyond that. Right? The day-to-day working is not my concern. There will be some general partners who will develop the property and who will be looking after the general management of the property. Now, these limited partnerships are only for a specific period. They are not indefinite. So they invest in the property. As and when the property develops, whatever the income of the property is, as rules of partnership says that you are supposed to distribute by this expenses, whatever the profits you are supposed to distribute to your partners. So, like a partnership, they are distributing whatever profits. And the share of the profits of each partner, limited or general, is specified in the partnership in advance. Okay? But it is for a limited partnership, 20, 30 people can come together and decide to do it for a specific period of time. Right? Then you nowadays you have something like, you know, rental property. Right? You invest in property only for the purposes of getting some rental property. And there is something like a vacation property. You've heard of Mahindra, Sterling, Club Mahindra, you would have heard of it. Now basically the option in this case is you buy one of those properties. Now they actually lease it out to you, okay, for a certain amount of time. And if you are not using that property during the holidays, you can lease it out to somebody else who will use the property and pay the rent for you. Okay? Some amount, the, you know, person who has developed the property, in this case Club Mahindra or Sterling, will use for administrative expenses, etc. Right? The rest of the income that the person who stays in your house for a certain amount of time as vacation, right, will come to you. Right? So they invest in a vacation property, and it's hugely popular in the US. It is gradually becoming popular in India. So that is another form of investment in real estate. So these are in terms of the avenues of investment in real estate. There's a last investment option which is called something like a collateralized, you can say, collateralized notes or mortgage. Now this is something like a securitization, right? You would have heard of collateralized mortgage obligation or pass-through certificates. Okay? Basically what happens in this is, suppose a housing company has given a loan to people who want to buy houses. Okay? Now, at a certain period of time, depending on whatever the EMI, they will keep paying the EMI, right? And HDFC or whatever the housing company will get those funds and get the return on whatever the loans that they need. Now, based on these receivables that they are getting, What they can do is issue, create a second class of securities which is based on the cash flows that you are getting. Okay? Now in some cases, for example, most of the time people will be paying their EMI money, and that's it. Some people may decide to prepay the loan. So on the basis of the expected cash flows of those properties or those loans, or on the quality of those loans, right? Because for example, if I'm doing it for residential purposes, possibly in residential purposes, right, you have a class of investors who are not likely to default. Okay? But if you're doing it for commercial purposes, like if you're given a loan for commercial purposes, possibly the chances of default are higher. I'm just giving an example, right? But there are various categories of people whom you give loan to and you assign rating that, you know, this is a good class, there, you know, possibly the default rate is going to be lower, another class the default rate is going to be higher. Right? So depending on, as I said, the, you know, type of loan and the default status, the credit rating of the loan, you can further create class of securities based on the cash flows and the credit rating of the loans and resell those loans. Right? And people will listen and you can charge interest on them. As and when the cash flows are coming out of them, right, you pay back those investors, because ultimately, like, you sold those notes, it's like a debenture, right? You've created a second class of securities on those. In that case, you sell them and people invest in them. They've given you money, right? From the point of view of the bank, right, you've got the money, you can further enhance your loan portfolio, right? It's a secure form of a securitization. So as and when the cash flows come from your primary people who have first taken the loan from you, you pay back the people who have bought a second mortgage, and that is what you are saying is a subprime mortgage on the same, because in this case you have created securities on those initial loans. On those initial loans, there is a certain amount of default. So if there is a default, the person who has secondly was that second class of securities that you have bought, obviously you are going to default on those. Right? So that is what the subprime crisis in the US is all about, because the primary class of the guys who have actually, you know, taken the loan from you in the first instance, right, those may have defaulted on the loans, and obviously on the secondary on the cash flow that you have actually sold further, created further securities, you will not be able to pay off, so you will end up becoming bankrupt. Right? So that is another form of investment in real estate. Of course, in India, it's still not very popular. They have started, some of them have securitized in this year, but it is not a very popular vehicle. In the US, of course, it's huge, right? Because you have the US mortgage market is really huge. But in India, it's still, right, there are some issues with regard to securitization, stamp duties, etc. So they have not really taken up, and the risk factor is obviously high. Right? So because of those reasons, that you would not have. Right? Now, lastly, what becomes when you are investing in real estate? Right? Now, either you are buying real estate or you are selling real estate. In both the cases, there is certain amount of valuation that you need. Now, suppose you are investing in a property. Now, what is the property, what is the value of the property that you would like to pay? Now, basically, there are three ways that you can do it. One is a cost approach, one is a sales approach, and the third is a net income approach. When I say net income approach, what it means is that what is the income that you are going to derive from this property? Now, which can be only based on whatever is the rental income that you are going to get, right, minus the expenses or the taxes that you have to pay, divided by an appropriate capitalization rate. Right? Now, the appropriate capitalization rate is the rate of return that you would normally expect on a real estate transaction, 10% or 20%. For example, let's assume that you are getting, let's say, 10,000 rupees per month on a rental property. So, in a year, you would get 1,20,000. Right? Now, on this, let's say, assuming that you pay house taxes, right? So let's say house taxes are 10,000 rupees a year. Then there will be some repairs and maintenance on that. Let's assume that's another 10,000 rupees in a year, right? So net effect of what you're getting is on that property is 1 lakh, right? So in a year, so suppose the rate of return that you expect on that real estate transaction is 10%. So 1 lakh divided by 0.10, right? You will get the value of the property, right? That is a net operating income approach, okay? Which means whatever the income that you're getting minus the expenses in terms of repairs and maintenance, divided by an appropriate capitalization rate, that is one approach. Okay? The other approach is the cost approach, which basically looks at that. Suppose if you were to construct a property in today's time, right, how much would it cost to construct it? So you take the value of the land, right, you take the quality of the construction, the cost of materials, the cost of labor, whatever fittings, etc., etc., depending on the quality of the building, and you figure out that this is the minimum cost that you put into it. The second approach is the sales approach. You basically look at the value that similar buildings in the area or in the property would have sold at, and you try and assess the value of that property. Right? So that is another way of looking at property. But again, I may say that when you are doing valuation of property, you need to consider that it is not something like, you know, a security or a share or a debenture, right? When a share or a debenture, there are lots of buyers and sellers. It's like a perfect market, right? But in a real estate transaction, there are so many variables, right? The location, the builder, the quality of construction, right? And your needs, the buyer's needs, right? You may be at a distress sale, the buyer may not need it, right? There may be so many land issues in it. Right? There may be something with regard to, let's say, your neighbor or the type of neighborhood that you have, or maybe, you know, there may be not be a supermarket in there, or maybe there may be something which has just come opposite it and a mall or something has come in, so there may be traffic on it. So because of those imponderables that you may have in those cases, the value of the property can vary, right? And it can vary from person to person, right? So it's not a perfect market, it's not very liquid, right? The rates of return are high. But there is a lot of cost in terms of maintaining real estate. The repairs and maintenance are there. Okay. For example, even if you are investing in rental property, right, suppose you rent out your house, right, so there is always the issue of the, you know, first finding an appropriate tenant, then the tenant pays, not pays, right, then he wants to, you know, do this, that. So there is a headache in terms of investing in real estate, which is not there in shares and securities. But having said that, also understand that it is an investment category which is totally different from shares and debentures or in instruments. The degree of correlation between, let's say, shares and securities and real estate may not be very high. Right? If the markets may not be doing well, possibly your real estate sector may not be affected. So the degree of correlation is not high. So as a diversification strategy, it always works. Secondly, land is scarce. It will always be scarce. It will always have value. So over the long run, there is absolutely no way you will lose out on real estate. And you will always manage to earn more than the rate of inflation. So, as a portfolio diversification device to beat inflation, right, it has low correlation in asset classes. Right, it always has some capital appreciation potential. Maybe 1 or 2 years, something, the property may not rise, but eventually you don't really lose on property, unless of course it is a distress. So that is really about